I want to ask you how these images make you feel. Do they make you feel nervous, anxious, fearful? Do they perhaps bring up some old memories for you? These are all images of things that people generally fear. Big spiders, large snakes. In addition, though, I could have said to you, how would you feel if I asked you to come up here and speak in front of a large group of people? Or how would you feel if I asked you to partake in a dangerous activity? Most people would be pretty stressed. Most people would feel anxious. This class is about reactions. And my concern isn't so much your emotional reaction as your physical reaction. When you feel those things, when you're fearful, anxious, and stressed, what does your body do? You have a change in your breathing rate. You breathe harder, you breathe faster. You have a change in your heart rate. You can feel your heart pounding and beating really hard. There's a change in your blood pressure. There's even a change in the size of your pupils. And that's what we want to talk about today. All of that is due to your nervous system. So your nervous system controls all the reactions of the body. Some of them you choose to have happen. They're voluntary actions, like I can raise my hand. But others are automatic. They happen without us thinking about it. We don't have to think about it. I always say, thank God we don't have to think about breathing. I would forget. I'm too busy. So these kind of automatic reactions, as well as reactions we choose, are all controlled by this system. Now, we can divide the nervous system up into several groupings. This is the central nervous system, and it's called central nervous system because it runs along the axis of the body and because it includes the most important part, the brain. Right? The brain, I always say, is like the mainframe of the body because it has great control over everything. Again, voluntary and involuntary. The brain is composed of neurons, very specialized cells that have the ability to electrically and chemically communicate with each other, with other neurons. And you have billions just in your brain. And they work extremely quickly, right? If I say, what's your name? Faster than I can snap my fingers, in a millisecond, you can answer. And think about that. You heard what I said. The information went to your brain and translated what those words meant, came up with the answer to the question, and then sent more messages to the muscles in your mouth, in your jaw, to your tongue, to your teeth, to your vocal cords, so that you could answer the question. That's pretty amazing, and it's fast. What most people don't realize, though, about the central nervous system is we also have a spinal cord, which attaches to the brain and is made of the same kind of tissue, neurons primarily. And think about the fact that your brain is so important that it's protected by your skull, by bone. So is the spinal cord. This soft piece of tissue is surrounded by your vertebrae. Again, protected by bone. Okay, so the second division of the nervous system is called the peripheral nervous system. Peripheral meaning outside of the central. The peripheral nervous system is composed of nerves. We're all familiar with that term, but now you know that nerves are groups of neurons that travel together. That's the definition of a nerve. And so these nerves, which exit out of our brain and exit out of our spinal cord, go to all different places. They go to muscles. So again, I can be talking to you. I'm making myself say these words. But they also go to your heart and keep it beating. They go to your digestive system and allow you to digest food. Your kidneys, which filter blood every second of our lives. So these nerves then bring information out, but they also bring information in, right? From all the world around us, from the rest of your body. You know when someone touches the bottom of your foot, even though it's super far from your brain, you still get that information. Okay, but I want to talk about the third division, which is different than the other two. It's called the autonomic nervous system. And I tell people, think of the word autonomic like automatic, because this is the system that we don't have any control over. This is the system that keeps your body functioning all the time. Again, we don't have to think about every organ and how it's working because of this autonomic, automatic nervous system. So, this system uses parts from the central nervous system and parts from the peripheral nervous system, and they come together to create this system. The autonomic nervous system itself has two divisions. One is called the sympathetic, and one is called the parasympathetic system. They cannot function at the same time because they're very much in opposition to each other. So let me start with the parasympathetic, and I'm going to start with that because that doesn't have anything to do with our scary spider and snake pictures, with talking in front of people or jumping out of a plane. The parasympathetic system is the one that is maintaining us, the one that is considered restful, the one that's active almost all the time. So in an extreme state, the most extreme time our parasympathetic system is working is when we're sleeping. Think about when you're sleeping, right? Your heart rate goes down. Your breathing rate goes down, your blood pressure's pretty low. What is your body doing when it's sleeping? To be honest with you, it's digesting food. Your digestive system is very active. Your kidneys, again, active, filtering blood. But you don't have a lot of blood, a lot of stimulation going to your muscles. You're not moving around that much, even though sometimes it seems like we do, when we're sleeping. Okay, so that's our maintaining restful state. So now let's go back to this big fear response that we all get, again, with different kinds of stimuli. It's not the same for everybody. That's your sympathetic system. So the sympathetic system, again, sends out nerves from the brain, from the spinal cord, and they go to organs. They released very powerful chemicals, neurotransmitters, and those cause a very fast overall reaction. Think back to when I started and when you first saw one of the photographs that may have caused a reaction in you. You react instantly to it. It's what we call a systemic response, meaning our whole system, our whole body reacts all at once. The reason is all those nerves are active at one time, are sending out their important chemicals and are alerting. That's really what it is. We're really causing an alert reaction in the whole body all at once. And you had the fast heart rate, and you breathed differently. And again, even your eyes had a change. That's what the sympathetic system does. This reaction, the stress reaction, is not meant to last a long time. It's not meant to happen frequently to us in our lives, because quite honestly, it puts a lot on the body. Not that it's a harmful state, but it can be if it lasts too long. So, why do we have this? Why send us into this very stressful, excited, heightened state? The body is preparing itself for what may happen. In animals, we call the sympathetic system a fight or flight response. And think about that. right? When an animal is in a super stressed position, oftentimes because of an opponent, whether it's a predator or another animal of its species, it has to make a super quick decision. Am I able to fight successfully and literally save my life? Or do I need to run, flee as fast as I can in order to save my life, right? It really is a life or death response when you think of the animal kingdom. Now, hopefully it is not that for us when we see a big hairy spider, not a life or death response, but our body reacts like that. So the blood goes to the most important organs. The blood goes to the organs that could help you in this stressful situation. So we want your heart to be beating faster and lots of blood going there. We want your lungs to be able to fill with air. And we want the blood to go to your muscles in case you run or need to fight, hopefully not. In addition, in this sympathetic state, we have heightened mental alertness. We are thinking right away. We have to make a quick decision. What do I do? Where do I go? What should happen next? What can I do to perhaps change the situation? So this is a good response. It's important that we have that because, again, it allows us, and the mental alertness helps, to make a decision, make the best decision for us at the time of what we should do. But I want to talk about two things that happen here. Okay, one is this absolutely is considered a stress state. And so people who are highly stressed for long periods of time can cause harm. They can end up with harmful conditions because the body is in a sympathetic state too much or for too long. It shouldn't be. Is college stressful? I bet everyone out there is laughing and shaking their heads. College is stressful. College students are often stressed, right? This is something you have to be careful of because staying in a very stressed state can really cause physical problems for you. Okay, so that's one thing to think about. The second thing to think about is for our whole lives, are we going to react in a stressed condition when we see a big spider or a snake or are at a very tall height? No. We can be trained to not react that way. Okay, let me give you a real example. If I'm in a hospital and I hear someone yelling code blue, I'm going to be kind of freaked out because I'm not going to know what to do. But the medical professionals, the healthcare professionals in the hospital, the doctors and the nurses and all the other medical people are trained. And when they hear code blue, it's an automatic response for them not to freak out, but to know exactly what to do. It no longer puts them in a sympathetic state. Just as, quite honestly, I'm not in a sympathetic state when I stand and talk in front of people because this is my job. This is what I do every day. I can't imagine being freaked out every time I'd have to do it. That would be a terrible professor. That wouldn't be a very good teacher. So it can be changed. Okay, one last thing. When we're in this heightened state of this physical reaction, we come into it very fast. Literally milliseconds is when it can happen. It's a whole activation. But it doesn't leave us that fast. It takes us a little time to calm down. Our breathing slows, our heart slows. We cannot calm down instantly from this state and go back into, hopefully, our restful parasympathetic state. I hope that helped you learn a little bit about the physical reactions that go on in the body. Thank you.